Okay, so now we start with the six short introductory talks. The idea is that they should make the panel discussion accessible also to non-experts. So the first of these short talks is going to be given by Professor Maximilian Fochla. He is an assistant professor and the head of the Department of Science and Technology at the University of Vienna. And he is also a member of the research platform Responsible Research and Innovation in the Academic Practice at the University of Vienna. And his research focuses on the shifting of institutional condition of knowledge production in contemporary academia and implication of these shifts in life and work of researchers. So.
Thanks, Julia. Thanks for the very kind introduction. It's a pleasure to be here and to say some words about some central moments of the history of the scientific publishing system, with a special focus on some lessons and points for discussion we can draw for the very kind of focus of this event today. Many thanks to the Dean for giving such good examples at the very beginning. I think I come back to them at one point in the talk also. They give a very nice texture that scientific communication has changed very much throughout history, and the debate around open access is just one more kind of round of discussion about how to communicate in science and how this relates to the kind of wider purpose and the social structures of science. It's always a pleasure to be here. Thanks again to the organizers for organizing such fabulously interesting events, cross-cutting to kind of issues that are very much at the heart of a lot of people in research today, I think. So I'll just jump right in, and I'll try to keep this as concrete as possible in the following, but I will make some general remarks to start with that are related to how I think about the examples that I'm going to give and what it means to talk about the history of scientific communication and publishing and how it has been changing. And I guess that first point is just to say, well, when we talk about communication, we never only talk about communication. So we can't separate the way that researchers, scientists communicate from everything else that they do and from the structural challenges that exists in academia, that also the kind of wider range of this kind of series of events, I think, is supposed to be addressing. So in slightly kind of technical terms, I would like to start with the assumption that the way that scientists communicate and the way that the communication of science is working out has co-evolved, and the way that the social structures of science, has evolved. And when I say that, I mean that on the one hand, of course, the way that scientists have been communicating has been changed by has been structured by changing technological means. So the format of the letter was mentioned in the example at the very beginning. Today, the internet and digitalization is very important, as we will see later. And also the way that science as a social system has changed from basically when those two gentlemen communicated via letter, they were aristocrats, they were very privileged people who did science more or less as a hobby, to a very large and very professionalized research system that we have today. All of this has changed the way scientists communicate, but in the very same vein, the way that scientists communicate has also shaped the social structures of science. So when you think about a journal, the way that a journal as an institution shapes the community around it and that gathers around it and exchanges in it in the same way as the community shapes the format of the journal. And so what I'm going to say in the next examples, in the next minutes, is really very much based on kind of linking those two things and saying we need to talk about broader changes in the science system too when we think about scientific communication. But for a moment, and I'm really going to just touch a few moments in the history of scientific publishing, let's go back to the very beginning. Let's go back to one of the places, arguably, where modern science, in the way that we think about it today, was born, and also communication in modern science was born and was kind of pioneered. The Royal Society in the 17th century. And let's look at this gentleman here, Henry Oldenburg, who was the founding editor of one of the first scientific journals, the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society, in the 17th century. And it's really fascinating to read those exchanges, as also in the example before, not only because they are really kind of curious from today's perspective, but because also we can read, when we read them, not only as historians, we can see how some crucial institutions of science were forged with the pages of these these early scientific journals. Like some very first kind of examples of peer review, even though as we learned that even up until the 20th century was not kind of, was still a hard work to establish, but also the kind of critical debate of empirical results. And what is important to see is that many things that today for us in science seem completely self-evident, like being criticized in peer review, were really hard work to establish against existing social rules, particularly in the 17th century, where saying a wrong word of criticism to the other aristocratic gentleman might even result in being asked for a duel or kind of having other kind of serious repercussions for your honor. So this had to be established for science to work. And that project, that journal was very important for that. So Henry Oldenburg did very noble work, but as we will talk a lot about commercialization today, I'm sure, I think it's also important to remark that the reasons why he did this very important and noble work were not all of them were that important and noble and high standing, but some of them were very commercial and were related to the fact that Mr. Oldenburg did not get paid at all as a secretary of the Royal Society, so he did want to make some money out of the things that he did for that journal. And so he started to write about the experiments that were going on at the Royal Society, and that was actually what started that first journal. And he started to write in ways that maybe in today's concepts were more like the Scientific American than they were like science, right? So they were not highly specialized. He was trying to address a relatively broad audience, of course, for that time, right? And he was trying to kind of deliver interesting stories to them about the experiments that were going on at the Royal Society and to get paid for that report too. And now the interesting thing is that some of those commercial motivations actually made him push some of the things we think to be crucial in science today. Like he really wanted to go, because it was interesting for the audience, he wanted to highlight controversies, he wanted to get the people into debate. So he was really critical in reporting about the experiments that were being performed, because he assumed that controversy was interesting to his readers. And that it was, but it also, of course, kind of got back to him. And at some point, and the kind of phase that the dean cited later, where letters were being written, is I think representative of that already, it was not sustainable anymore very quickly for the editor to write everything himself, because he was challenged by the authors that their papers were being misrepresented and other questions related to this. So he withdrew from writing and kind of took a more classical editorial role. And as soon as the author started to write, and there are very nice kind of linguistic studies about that, a moment of closure happened, right? From the Scientific American style, where the accessibility was supposed to be broad, language got much more technical, and there was a lot of exclusion already going on about who was able to read this very first scientific journal. Of course, there were lots of other exclusions there in the 17th century too. But that's, I think, a message that I would like to take from that very first example that I would like to refer to, that even in the very few first days of scientific publishing, exclusion was not only related to kind of physical access, but it was also related to language. And then, you know, what happened is an enormous growth of science. And this graph here, and of course we don't have very good solid data for that before 1900, just shows you the exponential growth of refereed academic journals throughout the 20th century. And that is paralleled, and that was a very hot debate, particularly around the middle of the last century, by a corresponding exponential growth of practicing researchers and scientists. Now, what happens in a system that grows that exponentially, it produces two kinds of effects happen. On the one hand, there is disorientation. So you have this enormous number of journals that is coming up, rising to the kind of 10,000, 12,000, and far beyond that, probably up until today. So the question is, as everybody of you who is a kind of practicing researcher realizes, you can never read all that stuff, not even the abstract, not even the titles. You can never keep up to date with that. So disorientation happens, and the need for orientation. And on the other hand, with that competition, and the growth also leads to competition between scientists. And that's a very important theme that the publishing business also takes up as an important structural function within the social system of science, in the 20th century that it is related to kind of professional competition and to career orientation of scientists. And then if I was to name one gentleman who I think understood those dynamics earliest and has contributed to them in a way that has changed the way that science is communicating today in incredibly strong ways, I would not point to the editor of a kind of classical scientific journal. I would point to this gentleman that you have on the slide here, Eugene Garfield, the inventor of the Science Citation Index and the founder of a range of companies, the Institute of Scientific Information, Thomson Reuters later, and now Clarivate Analytics, that provides what I would call meta information infrastructures that help researchers and that help libraries to orient themselves in that growing mass of scientific communication. And that also was its initial purpose, orientation, right? So the Science Citation Index was originally developed for librarians to help them which journals to buy based on the information which journals had most impact and were most read and most cited. Of course, we know that today the journal impact factor and metrics related to it are much more strongly used for the evaluation of academic institutions and individual academics in a probably much more important way than libraries buying decisions. So I'm stressing these information infrastructures because I think they are very crucial for us to understand how science works today, and they are also very crucial in the open access debate, in the sense that they, from the very beginning, have been corporate. So none of this has ever been public, whether you look to Google Scholar, whether you look to Scopus, whether you look to kind of Clarivate Analytics. There are more or less obvious links between academic publishers and these meta information infrastructures. And very importantly, the way that these infrastructures kind of categorize journals, the metrics based on them, have become key for individual careers and institutional performance competition. And so why do I mention that? I'm mentioning this partly to explain this next graph that I would like to show you that shows now going on from the 1970s to 2015, something that a lot of people in this room, I think, will be aware of, which is the kind of, if you like, oligopolization of scientific publishing, meaning that a very small number of large publishing houses are acquiring in this time more and more market power and are acquiring more and more kind of journals that are published with these specific publishers. And I would like to point your attention to two different facets of this. The first one being that, you know, there's a significant rise in the number, percentage of papers in different fields published in with the five major publishing houses, in chemistry from 40% to over 70% over that time. But secondly, also that fields are very different. So you have natural sciences, engineering, mathematics, and medicine fields here. And you can see, just to point to the difference between physics at the very bottom at 35% here in 2015, and chemistry with more than double of that at the very same time. And I think that's instructive, not only, you know, because we are in this building and those are the kind of two fields that are kind of here in this complex, but also if some of you have been following the criticisms to Plan S, the Open Access Initiative, for example, they might have noticed that a lot of criticism is coming from chemistry. And one of the reasons for this is also kind of mirrored here in the sense that chemistry has a very high concentration of journals with these kind of five big publishers. And so why has this concentration happened? And I think one of the main reasons for this is that these publishers also control to a certain extent, or that the meta information infrastructures that are related to them designate specific areas, specific loci of publication, specific journals as, you know, in the top quartile for example, impact factors for specific fields. And it becomes more and more important to publish in those journals, as many of you will know. And that, of course, is also related to a kind of increasing market power of journals in these specific fields. A second important thing, and I'm just showing you the kind of profits of those companies here of one specific company, Elsevier, here on that second slide, is also related to digitalization and to the fact that digitalization has done something to the economy of scientific publishing, which makes it very cheap for the publishers to kind of capitalize on the work of the individual academics and authors who are doing the work, the content-related work for this. And in that sense, the digitalization is also a main reason, I would say, and I would be happy to kind of discuss this later, for this kind of oligopolization that you can see here, which might seem, and I'll get to my kind of concluding points with that, which might seem relatively strange because, of course, digitalization opens a lot of possibilities for new open access journals to come up and kind of have an independent electronic infrastructure of their own. But if you look at it kind of throughout the second half of the 20th century, you can see that the digitalization was also the basis for a lot of kind of concentration within the publishing sector. So I'll just leave it, my kind of very brief kind of opening points from a kind of historical and social science perspective here, with five points that I would like to make based on the kind of examples that I've been given. The first one is that there are many forms of exclusion happening in scientific communication. Paywalls clearly are a very important one, but I think from the very kind of first example that I gave from the very first scientific journal, we can see that a lot of other forms of exclusion happen, for example, through language that are just as important to kind of keep in mind when one is kind of interested in making research more accessible. The second one is the point I just made about digitalization. The third one is related to kind of the corporate publishers, and you've seen those astounding kind of profit margins on the graph before. But again, saying the very beginnings of scientific publishing were also commercial to a certain extent. And I would just like to kind of point that even if it is, even if you know, current initiatives were successful to break the monopoly of the kind of big publishing companies, that doesn't necessarily automatically lead to a decommercialization of that form of publishing. And related to these meta infrastructures of information, I think it's important to realize that it's that what these big companies, where they get their market power from, is not because they can generate PDFs very well. It is because they control the kind of very central reputation structures that a lot of institutions like research funders or also universities think with. Sometimes the very same institutions that also kind of foster open access initiatives. And I think there is a certain tension there. And that's why my final point is that we can not address only access without tackling the corresponding information infrastructures and their role in scientific careers and institutional competition. I think it's highly problematic not to talk about the impact factor and the kind of information infrastructure behind it when we also talk about open access. And I'll leave it at that, and I'm looking forward to the discussion later. Thank you.
Papa.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Fochler. So maybe we can take one or two very, very quick questions if they are like a clarification question and not conceptual, maybe. Otherwise, keep them in mind, write them down, and during the panel discussion, hopefully there will be time enough. Okay, then in this case, I thank Professor Fochler again.